I knew there, like you, there has to be a way. If there's a will, there's a way.
You got that right.
Yeah. You know, I was shocked last night. I was talking to some of the people at the temple, and a lot of the guys are bringing guns to the temple.
And I've already planned that I'm going to do a meditation without it's wonderful.
program. Everything goes to see. I've ordered all the costumes, also the costumes. So I'm going to not put them, just skip them and jump them to the earth. And I can use them swimming down.
Doing it for
who?
Oh, gosh. Or,
Well, not too great.
Full moon November.
And then after they, I get them down, you know, to connect to the earth. Men have made it the busiest time. Thanksgiving, shopping, Christmas, none of it. So we can't really slow down like nature wants us to do. So then I'm going to give them that. Then come back, but then charge it because it's a full moon. I'm just waiting for one line. So given choice, she would rather have the birthday or the other year older.
That's right.
She only regretted one birthday. So she never regretted anything. She never regretted telling her age. But she only regretted one birthday. And it wasn't because she turned 30. Had that crisis. No, it's because she turned 30 with the moves. A gift from her kids to her going through the home at that time. She turned 30 That's the only birthday that is. But not for the reason of her
Thanksgiving. Well, we all did.
And every one of them is done. I can be an artist and I would go to deliver something. But every one of them, my brother's like, oh, I have a month. Jerry's picking one of these things. I don't know. He's picking one of the other three.
Oh, Jim, and you're such a of money. But well, she taught her 30 years of work in the school, 30 years of her at Judy Cooley. Do you know Judy?
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning
and welcome. Enter, rejoice, and come in, for today is a joyful day, and I am thankful that all of you are here, where we welcome all who come with open hearts, open minds, and a willingness to fellowship in peace and compassion. Welcome. As we light the chalice, as we kindle this flame, we honor and remember those who have passed into the mystery. Their brightness lives on in our vision. Their courage lives on in our commitments. And their love continues to bless the world through us. Florence Catlow. Now, if you'll join me with the reading of our covenant. You'll find it on the inside cover of your gray hymnal. It may be under your seat or in the seat from you, in front of you. And we'll recite it together. Love is the spirit of this fellowship, and service is its way. This is our covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, to promote a sustainable world, and to help one another. One of the greatest benefits, I think, of being a service leader, and for that matter, being a UU, is the opportunity to learn and expand our understanding of the world. Before today's service, I honestly was not familiar with the Festival of Samhain, but in my preparation for this service, I learned that similar to the Aztecs, the ancient Aztecs, holiday of El Día de los Muertos that we learned about last week with Candace, the ancient Celtic pagans celebrated Samhain around this time of year, and it is still observed around the world by pagans, Wiccans, witches, as one of the three harvest festivals, where it is acknowledged as an observance that brings in the darker half of the year. Samhain was a holiday celebrated that celebrated the honor the earth and the spirits who inhabited it. A holiday that was seen as an opportunity to harvest the last of their labor. And with the hazelnut being the last harvested, it became a symbol of Samhain as well. In Irish culture, they believe that during this transitional time of year, the veil between the physical and the spirit worlds is the thinnest, and the barrier between the dead and the living is dropped, allowing spirits to roam the earth and interact with the living physically. They believe during this time, people were most susceptible to supernatural forces such as ghosts, fairies, ghouls, banshees, spirits, and sprites. Some of these beings are benevolent and seek to play and celebrate, while others a little more evil and aim to do humans harm. So to shield themselves from these evil spirits, humans would wear animal skins or put on masks to hide their identities from the spirits. They would also leave food out as an appeasement to the spirits or ancestors and distract from ill-intentioned visitors. Sound familiar? To draw lines from ancient cultures around the world to what we do today has always been a really fascinating aspect of life for me. But that is a very brief and very shallow important version of an important holiday for several people in our congregation. So I will leave the real lesson to Serena to continue a little later in today's talk. The wages of sin is what? Thoughts of looking into the face of death at Samhain. Thank you, Serena, for being with us today and sharing that. Now we're going to go back to our gray hymnals for our responsive reading. It's number 468. Let me see. Yeah, we need one. It's 468. A little dyslexia there. So I will read the non-italicized words. You will read the italicized words. We need one another. We need one another when we mourn and would be comforted.
We need one another when we are in trouble and afraid.
We need one another when we are in despair, in temptation, and need to be recalled to our best selves again.
We need one another when we accomplish some great purpose and cannot do it alone.
We need one another in the hour of success when we look for someone to share our triumphs.
We need one another in the hour of defeat when we look for encouragement to endure and stand again.
We need one another when we come to die and would have gentle hands prepare us for the journey.
All our lives we are in need, and others are in need of us.
We do indeed need one another. And now it is time for us to share with one another our joys and concerns. If anybody would have a joy or concern they'd like to share with the community, you're welcome to come on up to the microphone, please, so that everybody online can hear us as well.
I just thought I'd tell you all, so you don't have to ask me, that my cataract surgery was beautiful. It went very well. I'm very happy. Until I look in the mirror and I see my face the way it really is and go, oh! But I did that this morning and made a face and I saw my dad. So, you know, that's not a bad thing.
It's funny, I think the same thing with my vision going. I don't mind it giving me a little natural filter when I do that. Would anybody else like to share a joy or concern for this week?
Yeah, any joys?
No. My joy is that everybody's here. Oh, Dusty.
I went to the interfaith dinner last night, and I just want to say it was a joy to be with other, I'll say, congregations, fellowships in this community. It was a great representation of two or three different faiths. And I just want to say the concern was I felt kind of crazy when they asked me for the ingredients in my thing. And I thought they wanted a recipe, but they obviously wanted to make sure it didn't have pork and different things in the items that I brought. So I learned a lesson.
Yes, Ben.
Hello.
Yeah, I guess my joy is music. You know, my son's been playing a lot more music. He started his first professional accordion lessons with this lady in town, one of the only people left in town that teaches accordion. She was sitting there kind of reminiscing. She was like, all the accordion people are dead. You know? But she's still around, and maybe he'll be a leader teaching later. You know, if he just keeps focusing. He's amazing and very passionate, better at music than I am too. But we're also doing at the Zen Gardens on Panama City Beach, an open mic jam session every Saturday night at 7:00. We were there again, you know, just playing and just goofing around, and man, it just all syncs up. Music is a wonderful, you know, language from God. It's just so amazing, you know. And you think about people that have dementia and things like this. That's what reaches them. Is the music, you know, so there's this unspoken, you know, in the back of our minds, this powerful, you know, experience, which is the language of music.
Awesome. Bob?
I want to bring up this shirt once again.
it says peace in Arabic and Hebrew and English. I just feel this sense of a real sadness in the world, and it's not. It's been going on for 75 years in the Middle East, and I just don't know the way out. And I know that there are lots of victims, and there's lots of complications, and it's very complex. And but we still can't turn our eyes away, and we need to keep it. We need to keep our eyes on the prize, on peace. And it's not going to be an easy path, but we need to keep that up. And it's not just in the Middle East. It's throughout the world, because there's victims of war going on right now in many places. So just be mindful, I guess.
Anyone else?
Rest coming up.
But
have
to
take my phone.
Is there?
No.
Yes, no.
Why is
that?
Because there are people
listening
online.
I appreciate that. I have bags of turnip greens. There's about 7 bags, all washed, ready to go on the counter. Help yourself.
Thank you.
That is a joy.
It's a joy.
My joy too is this weather. I love it. It's my favorite time of the year, October and November. So, any other joys and concerns we'd like to share? No? Serena?
I would like you to hold in your heart those that were spoken and those that were not spoken, while I read the meditation, and you can close your eyes or you can soften your gaze if you don't feel comfortable closing your eyes. This meditation comes from the Christian Bible, and it's one of my favorites. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek and a time to lose, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to sow, a time to keep silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. That's from Ecclesiastes in the Christian Bible. And I ask that you give a minute to this, the words. As we listen to and or sing our song, Spirit of Life. Thank you.
So we're 1057 in the teal hymnals. 123 in the teal hymnals.
Thank you.
We had some younger children here last week, and I thought we would include a time for all ages. And oh, I do see them here. Good. Well, this is a story for all ages. It's called Granddad's Prayers of the Earth, and I would like to read it to you at this moment. This is actually my grandson Anthony's book. It was inscribed to him by the author, Douglas Wood, and he just 2 days ago celebrated his 26th birthday. When I was little, my granddad was my best friend. Being with him always made the world seem just right. Granddad and I liked to go for walks in the woods together. We didn't walk very far, or very fast, or very straight. While we walked, I would ask him questions about things I wasn't sure of. Why is it, Granddad? I would ask. Or what if? Or does it ever? And one day, I asked my granddad about prayers. For a long time, Granddad was quiet. He didn't say anything until we came to the tallest trees in the forest. And then he answered with a question. Did you know, he whispered, that trees pray? I listened closely, but I couldn't hear them. See how they reach for the sky, he said. They reach and reach for clouds and sun and moon and stars. And what else is reaching for heaven but a prayer? I thought about the trees and I kept listening for them. And while I thought, I sat down on an old mossy rock. Rocks pray too, said Granddad. Pebbles and boulders and old weathered hills, they are still and silent, and those are two important ways to pray. Thought about hard about those rocks. Picked up a pebble and stuck it in my pocket. We walked a bit further and came to a small stream. The water splashed and sparkled, and tiny fish hovered in the shadows. Do streams pray too, Granddad, I asked. Streams pray too, he answered. And lakes and rivers and waters of all kinds. Sometimes they pray silently like the rocks. They lie still and calm and reflecting clouds or birds or sunsets or the first evening star. And sometimes they pray with movements flowing across the face of the earth, giving themselves to the ocean, giving themselves to the sky, and beginning their journey all over again. Sometimes waters pray with laughter, chuckling to their friends, the rocks. And sometimes they pray by dancing and leaping into the air and falling back again. These are all ways to pray, said Granddad, but there are more. The tall grass prays as it waves its arms beneath the sky, and flowers pray as they breathe their sweetness into the air. The wind prays as it whispers and moans and sighs. It is saying a prayer and singing a hymn at the same time. A bird prays when it sings the first song of the morning, and it prays in that silent moment just before it sings. And the robin's last song at sundown is an evening prayer. All the beings of the world pray, said my granddad, as they slip through the forest or sparkle in the water, as they climb mountainsides or soar into the clouds or burrow into the earth. Every living thing gives its life to the beauty of all life, and that gift is its prayer. And then we were quiet, Granddad and I. He was watching something far away, and I was thinking about all the things that he had said about rocks and trees and grass and birds and flowers. And finally, I asked him to tell me about the prayers of people. Granddad smiled and he ruffled my hair. He said, people pray some of the most wonderful prayers of all, he said. Bending down to smell a flower can be a prayer. Quietly watching the sunrise, feeling the slow turning of the earth, and saying hello to a new day is one of the oldest prayers. standing in a snowy woods on a winter day and watching your breath become part of the breath of the world, that's a way to pray. Making music or painting a picture can be a prayer. Holding hands around the table with family and friends, remembering all that holds us together and giving thanks is one of the greatest prayers. And sometimes, said Granddad, people pray when they're sad or sick or lonely or have a problem that's too big to carry by themselves. And they may say words that they have learned from their fathers or mothers or granddads or great-grandmothers. But often they must find their own words. The important thing to remember is that the words will always be right if they are real and true and come from the heart. We had walked far enough, and Granddad said it was time to go back, but I had one last question. Are our prayers answered, Granddad? I asked. Granddad smiled. He said, most prayers are not really questions. And if we listen very closely, a prayer is often its own answer. Like the trees and the winds and the waters, we pray because we are here not to change the world, but to change ourselves. Because it is when we change ourselves that the world is changed. My granddad and I went for many walks after that one, and I often listened to the prayers of the earth, but I was never sure I actually heard them. And then one day, my granddad was gone. And no matter how hard I prayed, he didn't come back. He couldn't come back. I prayed and prayed and prayed until I couldn't pray anymore. And so I didn't for a long time. And the world seemed like a dark and lonely place without my granddad in it. Until one day I went for a walk. I found a big rock under some tall trees and I sat down on it. Overhead, the branches swayed and a breeze whispered in the leaves. I heard a stream flowing nearby and a robin singing from a honeysuckle bush. And I heard something else too, something in the sound of breezes and birds and water. I heard prayers. The earth was praying, just like my granddad said. So I joined in. Thank you, I prayed, for tall trees and sweet flowers and steel rocks and singing birds, and especially for my granddad. And as I prayed, something changed, and my granddad seemed somehow near. And for the first time in a long time, the world seemed just right.
From now we take our offering. From you we receive, to you we give, together we share, and from this we live. We'll now take our offering. Welcome back to the podium, our longtime UU member and friend, Serena D. Latiolais, to the podium for her talk on The Wages of Sin is What? Serena?
Thank you.
Today's talk was supposed to have been a shared pulpit experience entitled The Prayer of Jabez and the Law of Attraction, or What We Focus On is What We Get. That's a sermon that I wrote and I delivered here at the UU over 10 years ago. And then after taking a class with others this past summer, I rewrote it, and I will, I promise, deliver this talk to you later on in the coming year. But due to some things that have happened in my life recently, death-related, and due to the time of year, Samhain specifically, I felt it necessary to change my topic. For many of us Earth-centered peoples, Samhain is a time of year, an astrological time, when the veil is very thin between the world of corporeal beings, that's us with bodies, and spirit beings. A time to reconnect with our ancestral dead, with those who have gone before us, who have made an impact in our life. Teresa did a great job explaining Samhain earlier, so I'm not going to talk too much about it, but I do want to say a few things. Believe it or not, Samhain is not the same as Halloween, which is a Christian holiday, now turned secular, that marks All Hallows' evening, the night before All Saints' Day. Samhain, on the other hand, is astronomically and astrologically, usually, sometimes, between the 3rd of November and the 7th of November. Now, in the pagan, earth-centered community where I spend a good deal of my spiritual time, we had an unexpected death a few weeks back. One of our young 31-year-old parishioners suddenly died. And last week, one of my grown adopted nephews called to tell me that his biological mother, who has suffered from cancer for many years, has finally succumbed. In fact, he's at the this at 1 o'clock this afternoon. They're having she's Southern Baptist, and they're having a memorial for her. So I am not a stranger to my mortality, to facing my mortality, as I lost my mother at the age of 6 in my 7th year of life. And my father, I lost when I was 9. I'm the 7th of 9 children, and only 3 of us are left. So it was with some consternation and disturbance that I first heard this passage in the Bible: the wages of sin is death. What? This statement speaks to me of a large amount of pro-human prejudice, because there is not one of us who is without sin, as in meaning missing the mark. That's the medieval term of the word sin. And I like it. If you sin, you've missed the mark. And not one of us is without sin, and therefore everyone will die. Well, that's a given, as the saying goes. But what's not so clear is, if the wages of sin is death, why do animals, or four-legged persons, or our feathered persons, or our plant persons, why do they also die? Because they are definitely, in my opinion, without sin, and yet they die. Have they succumbed to the wages of sin? I think not. Death in itself is a real discomfort to us all. And we as humans do not like to lean into that discomfort. In fact, we shy away from it to the point where we don't even say that person died very much. We generally say things like they passed on, or passed away, or crossed over. I have even heard a more clinical term, expired, like spoiled milk, which is not too far from the truth, because if you believe, as I do, that consciousness survives the body, then we are spiritual beings housed in a meat sack, and meat sacks tend to go bad and rot after a while. Well, what happens after death? I don't know. And that is not what my talk is about. My talk is how we can face death, any death, during this time of the year. And actually all year long, because deaths, like births, occur continually. While many of you may know me as an interfaith minister for alternative and comparative religions, and certainly as an earth-centered person, many of you may not know that I'm a druid. An archdruid is, to be exact, of the Order of the Clan of Donna, Fellowship of Isis. And as such, I feel that I may have a little bit of a different view of life and death than some of my more traditional brethren and spiritual sisters. The following article, which I'm about to read to you, is entitled Looking in the Face of Death at Samhain, and it was written by Dana O'Driscoll. Dana O'Driscoll has been an animist druid for almost 20 years, but currently serves as the Grand Archdruid in the Ancient Order of Druids of America. She is a druid grade member of the Order of Bards, Ovates, and Druids, and is the OBOD's 2018 Mount Hamas Scholar. She's the author of Sacred Actions, Living the Wheel of the Year Through Earth-Centered Spiritual Practice. It was Red Feather 2021. The Sacred Actions Journal, that's Red Feather 2022. And she's the author illustrator of the Tarot of Trees, Plant Spirit Oracle, and Tree Four Oracle. Dana is a certified permaculture designer and permaculture teacher, and she teaches sustainable living courses and wild food foraging. She lives in a 5-acre homestead in rural western Pennsylvania with her partner and a host of feathered and furred friends, and she writes at the Druid's Garden blog, and she is on Instagram at Druid Garden Art. And I found this article on Lyceum of the Sacred Tree, NPO, which is our public charity in West Bay. And I believe that it was my spiritual sister, Benita, who posted it. I'm not sure, but I think so. And I was very taken with the article, and I knew that it fit right into a lot of our UU beliefs. So I thought I would read it to you. So while I am reading the following article, I encourage you to either close your eyes or soften your gaze, because she will be talking about a climate zone which we in the subtropics may not be familiar with unless you were born or raised there. But the message is clear nonetheless. Death is death, and the wages of sin is not death. The wages of birth is death. Whether it be the birth of a human, a four-legged, a feathered, a crawler, or a plant, we are all going to die, to pass away, to cross over, to expire. In the words of Dana O'Driscoll, druid and plant person, I read the following article. As I write this, we have our last day before a freeze, the day before death comes to our landscape. On my landscape, in temperate western Pennsylvania, USDA Zone 6, we've had almost no frost to speak of. The summer has seemed endless. So we move into fall. Many of the plants are still quite lush, with pumpkins and peppers and tomatoes still growing. Many of the perennials know it is time to rest and have died back, sending their energy deep into their roots. But the tender annual plants don't have such a cycle, and here they generally grow till they are killed by the cold. And today is the last day of their lives, as tonight we've got a freeze coming. The freeze signals a definitive end to the middle part of fall and the start to late fall and eventually early winter. Samhain, summer's end, truly is here. I always find this moment a time before death, to take a deep breath, to recognize that everything is irrevocably changing in the next 24 hours. It feels strange to walk upon this landscape knowing it will never be the same, that a freezing night changes everything in this garden forever. I hold space for this land, knowing that while the freeze and the coming death is just another part of the cycle, it is a part of the cycle that is difficult. For my ecosystem, the first freeze is usually the target shift, the largest shift on my landscape that a single day has most of the other seasons we ease into and we ease out of, and things change slowly. But the freeze functions as a hard stop to the growing season for all but the most hardy plants. It signals that the time of high summer and even harvest is past, and how we look towards the cold and the dark. No matter how many times I live through this cycle with my plants or other loved ones, there's still something about this day, the day before death, that makes me take a serious pause. I do think this moment in time should be honored as a sacred moment. It's almost like today, the land is holding her breath for tomorrow, and everything changes. On this most momentous day each year, I like to spend a day like this tending the gardens, covering the plants that can survive a freeze, like our rapini and lettuces, moving other things in the greenhouse, and singing and leaving offerings for those plants whose time has come. Death isn't just present on the landscape outside. Death also has another kind of presence in my life right now. In the last few years, this world has experienced so much death of human persons, of animal persons, of plant persons. I have not been spared. And it sounds like in talking to others, very few of us have been. Seeing loved ones that take that inevitable march toward death and somehow trying to find peace in the experience, that's difficult beyond words. Just like the land here, I find myself holding my breath, wondering what tomorrow will bring, if death will visit yet again. I've spent a lot of time in hospitals and ERs lately with family members, and I'm likely looking at spending a lot more time in the coming months. And I can't help but see the parallels out here on the homestead and in my family life. We all have only so much time. Just like this coming frost, I have lately felt like I'm holding my breath. Culturally, here in the United States, it is not considered appropriate to talk about death. So we often don't talk about it. If you do talk about it, people grow silent, uncomfortable, or they may quietly slip away from the conversation. When we don't talk about it, we're not prepared to experience it. In the Druid tradition, we think about death as part of a larger wheel of the year. This wheel is replicated in many different aspects of our lives. Just as the wheel of the year goes from season to season, from the green spark of spring, to the heights of summer, to the harvest of fall, to the death and cold of winter, so too do our own lives mirror this process. We experience it each day with the cycle of day and night. We experience it each month in the phase of the moon. We experience it yearly with the cycle of the sun. And all of these natural processes teach us that the same process works in our own bodies and those of every single living being. Samhain is a time to naturally think about the death that comes to a landscape. The old is swept away, making space for quietude, rest, and eventually rebirth. For me, I don't follow the astrological or traditional Samhain on the landscape here. Rather, I wait for it to be present on the landscape. Thus, today is Samhain Eve, as we are the last day before the freeze. And tomorrow is Samhain, when death comes to my land. To mark this time, using more intuitive ritual approaches, I hold space today, being present on my land, bringing in the last of the harvest. I will cover those who can be covered, bid farewell to those who will be gone by tomorrow. I make offerings, sing songs, and spend the day simply present in those beautiful gardens. Tomorrow, I wake up early and observe the freeze upon the land as the light starts to come back into the land. I will observe the beautiful deadliness of the flowers and plants frozen with their thick layer of frost. By mid-afternoon, the true power of the freeze will be apparent in the browning and wilting of live summer plants. In a few days, all will be brown, and we will be a major step closer to our inevitable march toward winter. I've observed this cycle for many years, 2 decades almost, and yet each time it is unique, meaningful, and incredibly moving. It gives me a chance to reflect on the value of both living a full and good life, but also on the sacredness of death. It's not comfortable, but it's natural. Death isn't meant to be comfortable. It is meant to remind us that nothing is permanent. We are all here for a temporary amount of time, and no fighting or begging or prayer can change that. We all belong to the same cycle of life as everything else. And this is a reminder of our place in all of it. But spending time with it this time of year can help prepare you for the inevitable experience of death in your life. If you live in a temperate environment, holding space at sound for the death that comes can be a deeply moving experience. Perhaps this hasn't yet happened on your landscape this year, or it could be happening tonight if you live anywhere along the upper eastern seaboard of North America. Regardless, I suggest you pay attention to the forecast and those liminal points just before and after the freeze. Walk your local land before the freeze, observing and holding space. Get up at the golden hour just before the sun comes over the horizon and see the terrible beauty of the frost. It is useful to visit a flower garden or something similar to really see the impact. Come back later in the day or the next day and again observe these major changes upon the landscape. These can allow you to build that relationship with death in your own life, to learn how to accept it as a natural part of all of our experience, and to ease yourself into the coming darker and colder times of winter. End of article. I've read this about 4 times now, and every time it really moves me. How close we are to nature and how we need to reconnect with nature in this way. So in my opinion, while the wages of sin is not death, the wages of birth is definitely death. And death comes to us all sentient and living beings, plant and or animal alike. May we all go forth into the darker time of the year with a more wholesome approach to death as part of the circle of life. And thank you for giving me this opportunity to serve you yet again. Namaste and blessed be.
Thank you, Serena. Now, if you'll once again grab your gray hymnals, we're going to sing our closing hymn, number 324, Where My Spirit Onward Leads. I believe Gary's going to play through it one time, and then we'll pick it up on the second round. Stand as you're willing and able. Thank you.
As we leave this loving place, let this light shine on every face, and may its continued warmth continue to burn and in every heart until we return. Thank you for sharing your time with us this morning. We're going to have our, and thank you for extinguishing our chalice. We're going to have our announcements really quick, and then we'll have our closing hymn, Go Lift It Up. We're also having potluck Sunday, so make sure you stick around for that. Even if you didn't bring something, not a problem. We always have plenty, so make sure you stick around. Bob, announcements?
Morning.
Good morning.
On November 12th, this is the upcoming services, November 12th, Cindy G is going to do the 12 steps of recovery. What we all can learn from a couple of drunks. And November 19th, Steve Bornhoff, once again, will be speaking to us on the importance of meeting people where they are. On November 12th, we will have a band book club meeting. We're going to be speaking. We're going to be doing from the reading of the book Mouse. If you haven't read it yet, it's a really, really good book. It's a short read. It's a graphic novel. And it's next Sunday. And there's a meditation class. It's on Tuesday nights at 7:30. It's available on Zoom. It's only an hour, and it really can make a difference in your life. I would really encourage people. There's three more sessions left. Look for the Zoom link in the news, e-news. Or
on the website. It's also on the website.
November 20th, let's be thankful together. Our annual Thanksgiving brunch starting at 11 a.m. Sign-up sheet is at the UU or contact Sharissa Thacker. For details, RSVP, there's a sign-up list over there, I believe. And December 21st, come celebrate the solstice with a campfire to warm our flesh and our souls. This month, the UU Soul Matters theme is Gift of Generosity. And please note, there is a display of generosity on the bulletin board up over there, nicely done by Arlene. If you're interested in a Christmas Day brunch, see me. We're going to try and organize it if we have enough people that are interested in meeting together at Christmas and eating together. A friendly reminder that our food pantry items are really needed. We almost ran out this week. Every day it has been coming up empty, and I think there is a real need out there. We also continue to collect aluminum cans for family services. And there's lots of other information on our website and our newsletter and Facebook. And Sharissa wanted to speak about safety, Arlene.
I just had a question about the Christmas brunch. So this is Christmas Day, the day after Christmas Eve service here in the evening. They have a Christmas brunch on Christmas Day.
On Christmas Day.
So that's a Monday, right?
Yes.
Right, the Christmas brunch would be on Christmas Day.
Okay.
Yep.
So I have one more announcement in the effort to be, it came up at the social, in the Interfaith Harmony Council. There is a special day of mindfulness on Saturday, this coming Saturday, from 8:30 to 4. Led by Master Tran at the, what do we call this? The Quanam Monastery. It is apparently a wonderful event that Ron, who is the pastor of Unity, has been to, and he really enjoyed it. So if you're really somebody who likes meditation and needs a day, it's a good time to do this. It's a really good time to take off from the world and do something else. It's an all-day thing. They do a vegan lunch, vegan, vegetarian, vegetarian lunch, and there is a $50 donation, but anyway, I thought I would let you all know about it because it's really an event that's worthwhile.
It's a great opportunity to learn something new as well.
Any other announcements?
Well, so the board wanted to start talking a little bit about safety as well for the UU, and just as a quarterly event, we're just gonna kind of remind folks of some of the safety aspects of the property. We do, you know, a lot of times, a lot of people don't go into the back rooms, but we do have two different exits in the back. So if something were to happen here in the main sanctuary area, there is exits in the back, both back rooms back here, just to make sure everybody is aware. There's also a door in the kitchen, if you had never noticed that as well. There's a door in the kitchen that leads out into the ramp. The door back here is also a ramp exit as well, if it's needed for the handicap. We also had just purchased a new first aid kit. I found our old one and it was a little expired. So I went ahead and ordered a brand new one. It's in the kitchen on the counter at the moment, but we will find a home for it in one of the cabinets there above on the left. And it will have it be indicated in that cabinet by the red first aid kit. So if you do need something, Band-Aids, medicines, whatever have you, you'll know where it is. It'll be identified there in the kitchen. But so that everybody is aware, it is also in there. Also, because we do a lot of cooking and dinners and such, we do have a fire blanket that's also going to be posted in the kitchen. That's just a simple, no need for the fire extinguishers and things like that. It's a simple pull the tabs, throw the blanket on the fire, and you're done. So thank you. I appreciate your patience with that. There'll be more things about safety in the future, but I just wanted to cover those two things for now, and more of that to come, so that everybody's on the same page. If somebody from the board isn't maybe here at the time and you need to know that information, we're all stay good and safe. Anything else I'm forgetting? No? All right. Well, please stick around for the potluck. If you'll join us in our closing hymn, number 1057 in the teal hymn book. I know the words. I don't usually grab the book anymore. So, yeah, it's in the teal hymnal, 1057, if you'll stand and join us if you're willing and able. And then soon after that, we'll get the tables out at the start of the potluck. Thank you all for joining us, and I hope you have a great week.